This is Concept E Classes and today we'll study Chapter 5 of Class 8 Social Science Civics Judiciary. So Unit 3 of your Civics book is the Judiciary and it consists of two chapters, Chapter 4 Judiciary, which we are going to discuss in this video, and Chapter 5 Understanding our Criminal Justice System. So first in this chapter we'll see what is the role of judiciary, what is an independent judiciary, what is the structure of the judicial system or the structure of courts in India, and what are the different branches of the legal system, and does everyone have access to the court? So let's begin the chapter. So in the last chapter, we saw about some of the laws, like the law specifying the age of the marriage or the age at which a person can vote. And we also studied about the rule of law. What was the rule of law? It's every person is equal under the law and no person is above the law. And if any person violates the law, they should follow certain set of fixed procedures. So to enforce or uphold this rule of law, we have a judicial system that consists of courts that a citizen can approach when a law is violated. Hence, we can define judiciary as a system of courts that interprets, defends and applies the law in the name of state. Now the judiciary as an organ of the government plays a very important role in the functioning of Indian democracy. We have already studied that there are three organs of government, which was the legislature, executive and judiciary. And judiciary plays a very important role in the functioning of India's democracy. And the judiciary can play this role only because it is independent. So we'll learn more about independent judiciary in the following slides. So we saw what is judiciary. Now let's understand what is the role of judiciary in our country. Now courts takes decision on a large number of issues. For example, they can decide that no teacher can beat a student, or about sharing of a river water between the states. The courts can even punish the people for particular crimes. If you see the newspaper, we can understand a range of work done by the courts in this country. So broadly, the work that the judiciary does can be divided into the following. The first one is dispute resolution. Now the judicial system, it provides a mechanism for settling any disputes between citizens and citizens, between the government and the citizens, between two state governments, and even between the center and the state government. Secondly, judicial also does a judicial review. So let's see what is a judicial review. The judiciary is considered as the final interpreter of the Indian Constitution. Hence, it has the power to strike down particular laws passed by the parliament if it believes that these are a violation of Constitution. So the judiciary, it has the right to strike down any laws that is passed by the Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha, if those laws are a violation to the Constitution. And this process is called as judicial review. Now judiciary, it also upholds the law and enforce fundamental rights. Every citizen of India, they can approach the Supreme Court or the High Court if they believe that their fundamental rights have been violated. So let's discuss one such instance where the citizen have approached the Supreme Court for their fundamental right. So you might have already studied in class 7 about the agricultural laborer Hakim Sheikh, where he fell from a running train and injured himself, and his condition got worse because several hospitals refused to admit him. So he filed a case in the Supreme Court. On hearing his case, the Supreme Court ruled that Article 21, which provides every citizen the fundamental right to life along with the right to health. So the Supreme Court, it made sure that the justice was upheld. So they directed the West Bengal government to pay him the compensation for the loss he suffered. So here, in short, Hakim Sheikh, he was a citizen where his fundamental right was violated. So he approached the Supreme Court and the judiciary made sure that the fundamental right was upheld. Next topic is what is independent judiciary. So the previous slide we saw that the judiciary plays a very important role in the democratic India, mainly because it is independent. So let's understand what this independent judiciary is through this example. Imagine a situation in which a powerful politician has invaded or occupied your land. And within this judicial system, the politician has the power to appoint and dismiss the judge. So take this case to the court. The judge will surely be partial to the politician, as the politician has control over the judge. So the judge cannot take any independent decision. And this lack of independence would force the judge to make all judgments in favor of that politician. And we will not get justice. So although we often hear of this rich and powerful people in India trying to influence the judicial process, the Indian constitution, it protects against this kind of situation by providing the independence of judiciary. So one aspect of this independence is the separation of powers. We have already studied about the separation of powers in the first chapter under the key features of constitution, where the other branches of the government, like the legislature and the executive, they cannot interfere in the work of judiciary. And the courts, they are not under any government and they do not act on their behalf. For the above separation to work well, it is important that the judges of the Supreme Court as well as the High Court are appointed without any interference from any branch of the Indian government. And it is difficult to remove a judge once he has appointed to the office. Hence, it is the independence of this judiciary that allows the court to play a central role in ensuring that there is no misuse of power by any members of the legislature as well as the executive. And the judiciary also plays a very important role in protecting the fundamental rights of the citizen. Now let's discuss about the structure of courts in India. Now there are three different levels of our court in our country. There is only one court at the apex level or the highest position, which is the Supreme Court, followed by the High Court, and there are several courts at the lower level, which are usually called as district courts. So first let's see about the district courts. Now the courts that most people interact with are called as subordinate courts or district courts. And these district courts are usually found at a district or tehsil level or in towns. And they hear many kinds of cases. Some of the examples of district courts are the district courts in Purulia, district courts at Koratput, Jaipur, and this is the district court in Haridwar. And this district courts are presided over by a district judge. Now let's see about the High Court. Now, each state has a High Court, which is the highest court of that state. Or in other words, we can say that High Court is the supreme judicial body in a state. Now, High Court was first established in the three presidency cities of Calcutta, Bombay and Madras in 1862. So, these are the High Courts in the three presidency cities. The High Court of Delhi, it came up in 1966. So even though our country have about 29 states and 7 union territories, there are only 25 high courts in our country. That is because some states like Punjab and Haryana, they share a common high court in Chandigarh. 4 northeastern states of Assam, Nagaland, Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, they have a common high court at Guwahati. Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, Hyderabad, they have separate high courts from 1st January 2019. So these are the red spots shows the position of high courts in our country, and we have only one Supreme Court, which is at Delhi. So we have currently 25 high courts in our country. So now let's see about the Supreme Court. So at the top is the Supreme Court that is located in New Delhi, and it is presided over by the Chief Justice of India. So now the Chief Justice of India is Sharad Aravind Bobde. And this Chief Justice is the head and the chief judge of the Supreme Court. And the decisions made by the Supreme Court are binding on all courts in India. So that is, the decisions made by the Supreme Court should be followed by all the courts in India. Now, are these different levels of court, that is the Supreme Court, the High Court or the District Courts, connected to each other? Yes, they are. In India, we have integrated judicial system. That is, the decisions made by the higher courts are binding on the lower courts. So we can understand this integration through the appellate system that exists in India. Now, what is this appellate system? It means that a person can appeal to a higher court if they believe that the judgment passed by the lower court is not judge. So let us understand this appellate system by tracking a case, State Delhi Administration versus Lakshman Kumar and others, 1985, from the lower courts to Supreme Court. So let's see the case. In February 1918, Lakshman Kumar married Sudha Goyal and they lived in Delhi with Lakshman's brothers and families. On December 2nd, 1980, Sudha died in the hospital due to burns. So her family filed a case in the court. When this case was heard in the trial court, four of her neighbors were called as witnesses. And they stated that on the night on December 1, they heard Sudha screaming and had forced their way into the Lakshman's flat. There, they saw Sudha in flames and they extinguished the fire by wrapping Sudha in a gunny bag and a blanket. Sudha told them that her mother-in-law Shagundala had poured kerosene oil on her and her husband Lakshman had lit a fire. So during the trial, the witnesses stated that Sudha had been subjected to torture by her in-laws as they were demanding more cash, scooter and fridge on the birth of the first child. So as a part of their defense, that is Lakshman and his mother, they stated that Sudha's saree accidentally caught fire while she was heating milk. So on the basis of this and some other evidences, the trial court, they convicted Lakshman, his mother Shagundala and his brother-in-law Subhash Chandra and sentenced all three of them to death. So later in November 1983, the three accused went to the High Court to appeal against this verdict of the trial court. The High Court, after hearing the arguments of all the lawyers, decided that Sudha died due to accidental fire and Lakshman, Shagundala and Subhash Chandra, the three accused, they were acquitted. Acquitted means they were relieved from the charge. They were declared not guilty. So in 1985, Sudha's family, they appealed against the decision of the High Court in Supreme Court against the acquittal of all the three accused. So the Apex Court, which is the Supreme Court, heard the argument from both sides and reached a decision that was different from that of the High Court. Lakshman and his brother were declared guilty according to the evidence. However, his brother-in-law was not guilty since there was a lack of evidence against him. And that accused brother-in-law was sent to the prison for lifetime by the Supreme Court. So this is an example of the appellate system. Now let's discuss about the two different branches of legal system, which is the civil law and the criminal law. Now the case of dowry death, which we now just saw, falls within what is considered to as a crime against the society and it is a violation of criminal law. And other than this criminal law, the courts also deal with civil cases. For example, in the last chapter, we saw how a new law was passed in 2006 to protect women against domestic violence. So that law comes under civil law. So now let's understand some of the significant differences between criminal law and civil law. Now, criminal law, it deals with the conduct or acts that the law defines as offenses. For example, theft, harassing a woman to bring more dowry, murder, this all comes under criminal law. The civil law, it deals with any harm or injury to the rights of the individual. For example, disputes relating to the sale of the land, purchase of goods, rent matter, divorce cases. So these all comes under civil law. In criminal law, it all starts with the lodging of an FIR first. That is a first information report with the police who will investigate the crime. And after that, the case is filed in the court. And if found guilty, the accused can be sent to the jail and also fined. In civil law, first a petition has to be filed before the relevant court by the affected party only. For example, in a rent matter, either the landlord or the tenant can file a case. And the court, it could give the specific relief asked for. For example, if there is a case between the landlord and the tenant, the court can order the flat to be vacated and pending rent should be paid. Now, does everyone have access to the courts? In principle, all citizens of India, they can access the court in the country. That is, every citizen has a right to justice through courts. As we already read earlier, the courts play a very important role in protecting our fundamental rights. So if any citizen believe that their rights are being violated, they can approach the court for justice. While the courts are available for all, in reality, access to a courts have always been difficult for a majority of poor people in India, because the legal procedures, they involve a lot of money and paperwork, as well as they take up a lot of time. And for a poor person who cannot read and whose family depends on a daily wage, the idea of going to court to get justice often seems remote. So in response to such a situation, the Supreme Court in early 1980s devised a mechanism of public interest litigation, or PIL, to increase access to justice. So it allowed any individual or organization to file a PIL in the High Court or the Supreme Court on behalf of those whose rights were being violated. Or in other words, we can say that PIL is the use of law to secure human rights and equalities and help in providing justice to those whose rights were being violated. And any individual or organization can file a PIL in High Court or Supreme Court. And the legal process was greatly simplified. Simply a letter or a telegram addressed to the Supreme Court or a High Court could be treated as PIL. And in early years, the PIL was used by activists to secure justice on a large number of issues, like rescuing the bonded laborers from inhuman work conditions, securing the release of prisoners in Bihar who had been kept in jail and even after the punishment term was complete. So let's take another example where justice was served through PIL. So in 2001, several Indian states like Odisha and Rajasthan had to face severe drought where millions faced an acute shortage of food. Meanwhile, the government godowns, they were full of grain and it was eaten away by rats. So in such a situation, an organization called the People Union of Civil Liberties, or PUCL, filed a PIL in the Supreme Court. And it stated that the fundamental right to life guaranteed in Article 21 of Constitution included the right to food. But the state's excuse was that it did not have adequate food. But it was shown wrong because the godowns were overflowing with grains. So the Supreme Court ruled that the state had the duty to provide food to all. And the Supreme Court made sure that the government had to provide more employment and also provide food at cheaper prices through ration shops and provide midday meals to children. And the Supreme Court also appointed two food commissioners to report on the implementation of government schemes. So through PIL, the justice was served to the citizens in Odisha and Rajasthan. However, sometimes certain court judgments that the people believe work against the best interest of common person. For example, the activists who work on issues concerning the right to shelter and housing for the poor believe that the recent judgments related to the evictions are wrong, because the recent judgments, they tend to view such people living in slum areas as an encroacher or like trespassers or intruders. So such judgments, they work against the best interest of common man. Another issue that affects a common person's access to justice is the long number of years that the court takes to hear a case. That is, the Indian court, it takes a number of years while hearing the case. And the phrase "justice delayed is justice denied" is often used to characterize this extended period that the court takes. One such example is the instance where about 43 Muslims of Hashimpura were killed on 22nd May 1987. And these families, they fought for justice for over 31 years. due to this long delay in the commencement of the trial, the Supreme Court in September 2002 transferred this case from the state of Uttar Pradesh to Delhi. And finally, the Delhi High Court convicted the accused persons on 31 October 2018. So this family, they fought for the justice for over 31 years. However, in spite of all these flaws, there is no denying that the judiciary has played a very important role in democratic India by serving as a check on powers of the executive and legislature, as well as protecting the fundamental rights of the citizens. So that's all for Chapter 5, The Judiciary. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.